So in this session we'll learn all about settings. So there are certain settings which are outside of the application, common for the entire application itself. Those settings will come as under this menu called application configuration. Okay, see in the options what all we have here. We have a help manual link which will link to the online help manual. Check for updates, we have already seen that this will update the software automatically. Then we have database configuration, in which I'll just explain you what each of this purpose does. Configuration will help us to connect to some different database server. Whenever if the database is on some other server, maybe there is multiple engines or multiple server installed on the same system. That time we can switch to some other server using this configuration. In case if the database is installed on some other system also, we can connect to that system via being in LAN, or if it's over static IP, you need to mention the IP address on which database is available. Using database configuration, we can connect to any of those database servers basically. Attach is for attaching a book. Detach is for removing a book from the list. Now this book is there, blank DB. If I just go to options, database and detach, and take this, this book will get removed from here. So once we have detached the database, we go back, we find there's no book here. See, whenever we are formatting a client system, we need to, or we are shifting the data from one system to other system, first we need to detach the databases and then we will surrender the license, then we will copy the entire folder. If the database is attached and if it's not local DB, then it will not allow you to copy the SQL database from this system to other system. Basically, when the database is attachment, it is connected to the SQL services, the engine. See, again, I am just selecting this one and I'm clicking attach here. And this book gets connected, and now the second one is not connected, so I can even delete that book or I can move that book. But till the time if when database is connected to an SQL engine, you cannot move or you cannot rename, you cannot do anything to that. It is completely secure. Basically, it's in a read-only mode from the external Windows side. Try to delete that file, it will say access denied. Basically, it is connected to the SQL services. The alternative way of moving a database from one system to other system is either you detach it or you stop the SQL service by going to services.msa. At the back end, if you stop the SQL services, then you can do any alteration to the database. You can copy or you can again move or delete. Renaming will anyhow not work directly because the SQL server has one internal name also. This has to be equivalent to the file name, otherwise there's certain other process to do the changes on those. So what else is available in the options? Next we have configure demo database. If I click this, automatically our demo database which is available on internet, that will get downloaded and get configured in this one automatically. So demo database has also come now, if you can see here. In this, we generally use this for presenting reports to the customers, where this will have some extra demo data and all the reporting would be available in this. Graphical reports can be seen. Instead of customer entering the data and then seeing the reports, this will have data across all the 12 months, purchase, sales, returns, and they can just directly see the reporting in this. Usually we prefer entry part, they can verify in a blank database where they can create their own set of products and view the flow of the sales, purchase, inventory. And for analysis report and for some graphical dashboards and all, since data will be less, viewing them in the demo database of their own will not be much helpful, where they can use our demo database and see those kind of reports. Then we have string call database and repair all database. String call database will just remove or reduce the database size. Basically, it will remove all the temporary memory which is there in the database, any extra spaces. The size will get reduced automatically. Repair all database will again verify all the database integrity. If the database is all correct, database has a lot of other things inside. So in case sometimes there are chances where database is corrupted, there are alternative way to repair it. Generally we have given this option. If this repair is not working correctly, then the alternative way is to use the management studio and pass the necessary commands for repairing the database. Those commands are available in our FAQ. This is part of troubleshooting only. Generally it will happen here itself. In case if it doesn't happen, then we have to use Management Studio. It will give you a message after the repair process is completed. It will verify each and every database that is available in this engine now. Current database server is Dell PC. Dell PC is the system name. when we install Max ERP, the default system name itself will be the server. Basically, we are not having any additional instance name or the server name. We have three database servers on this. Three database server in this particular system. We've seen the last demo where the installation demo. In the system, we have Dell PC/Max 2008, Dell PC/Max 2012, and with the last session where we saw the installation, by default it will install the MS SQL Server. Default instance name is MS SQL Server, which is not shown here. It will install as the system name itself. And internally, when you go to services, you'll find SQL Server bracket MS SQL Server. That is the default SQL Server installation that happens. Next, we have backup data and restore data. Set up a new book, we have already seen. License detail will have the details of the application. Right now, it's in demo version, so nothing will be open. We will have the license detail in the other instance where we have Max Enterprises. Here, we'll have the license detail coming in. License detail will show you the information against which, the license detail against which the customer name and the email ID and the mobile number, the date of activation. Those details come in the license detail. About Max will take us to the Max ERP website. We'll learn about backup data and restore data. What is backup data? See, backup data is a utility by which we can create a copy of the database in either in a pen drive or in some other external drive or in the same system itself. Just for our safety purposes. In case if the system gets corrupted or if the hard disk gets crashed, in case if we have an external backup, if the customer has an external backup, then software can come from our side, data they have to maintain. Alternatively, even the backups are used when we are shifting the system, or if the client has two licenses, one in office, one at home. Then he might work at office, he will take a backup in a pen drive, and then he will restore at home. Restore is nothing but getting the data back from the pen drive to the system. Backup means, let's assume an example that we need to take a backup from office and restore it at the home. So we'll insert a pen drive and we'll select the directory here of the pen drive. We'll just select any E drive, D drive, whatever it is. And we'll click OK. Assuming this being a pen drive, we'll select which books we want to take backup for. Either we can do select none or select all, or we can just select one particular book. Super compress is one extra option available here. What this does is, this will take little extra time for the backup to happen. But then the backup size will be almost 25 to 30% of the original file size. If a normal compression is making a 50 MB file, super compress might make it up to 25 or 20 MB file. It will reduce further. Only thing is, it consumes little more extra system resources, extra memory. It will take little extra time for the compression to happen, because it will compress in a very high mode, in a detailed mode. So extra compression happens. Why we use this option is, certain clients will have larger databases, and when we want to transfer their data over TeamViewer to our system for any inspection purpose or any verification, then that time, or if the pen drive size is small and we are constrained to the space, or we want to upload the file to some server, in that scenario we'll use a super compressed option.
See, in the backup, no, we can do backup, and after that we should paste it into some other drive.
It's not necessary. Where do you want the backup, you can keep it there. Now, assuming the scenario where we want to take a backup from office and use it at home during weekends, and again from home we will bring it back to office on a Monday. So for example, in that scenario, we'll put a pen drive. Select the directory of the pen drive by either selecting the drive here, or you can even type the address here. Select the book which you want to take backup for. Super compress generally is being used by us. We don't recommend for the customers.
Yeah.
If you want to transfer file over TeamViewer, it will be faster for us.
Yesterday, Deepak, he asked me to do a backup and after it went to a drive, and after it could understand what was happening.
Went to a drive for what now? Now I've just given E drive and I've clicked a backup.
Okay.
So it will create two files in the backup. One would be the data file that you have selected, and second there'll be a config file which will come in. When you see the E drive now, there'll be two files. This file has the complete name and path, if you can see. Max ERP 2017, 10th, which is October month, 12th day,
okay.
10 o'clock, 12 minutes, 52 seconds, and the database file name, blank DB 17, blank 1718, and then again a date, 12 October. For a quick identification purpose, what date, what time the backup has been taken. And then it will create one more extra file saying config. What does this file hold means? This file will have all the settings, all the data print formats that crystal reports, the layouts that have been designed, and the files, attachments, everything will be there in this.
Okay.
So in case if the system gets corrupted with config file and with the last database, we can always bring it to the same mode very fast.
Okay. In case if you are putting in our system, means the client have to take this
config? No, not required. In our system, we generally take only this, the data file. Config file is not required.
And then we paste in the company's name so that we can
write it and give it back to them. No, we paste in the company's name. Company name is already there, no?
Yesterday, Venus, we didn't know what to do to post it. We paste in this
folder
in data transfer.
Ah, that is okay. We created one folder for our internal purpose.
That means you have to take only the configuration part at the bottom.
Configuration is not required unless it's specifically informed to you. All the database file name will start from Max ERP.
Okay.
Okay. And now, assuming the backup has been taken in a pen drive,
yeah.
you go to home, and what you do at home, you go to options and you click restore. In restore, you can select the file in from which directory you want the file. So let's say we are taking the file from E drive. So I select E drive and I give OK. All the files from E drive will be shown. If you have multiple backups, all the backups with the date time will be shown. The latest backup will be at the top, the oldest will be below. If I have three backups, it will show you all three with different date and time, because every backup has the hour, minute, second. So every backup will be in a different date time. So at home, you can just click this and you can click restore. What does this restore does? Your existing data, if you have made any changes, that will get overwritten with this backup.
Okay.
If you have done some work at home also, and then you are placing this backup over it, you are restoring the office backup, then the home backup will go off and this backup will get overwritten. So this will be active file now. So you just select the drive from where you want to restore. You select all the files will be listed. You can select which one you want, which data you want to restore, and you can click restore. If this book is not there, if the blank DB is not available at the second location, then if you restore, it will create a new book. Assuming this is the first time you are taking a backup to your home, in the home there won't be this book setup. So there you can directly click restore. It will create a new file for you. Clear? So backup and restore is clear. What is the use of super compression is also clear. When we take a backup of customer's file, we will click super compress, we will store it to Max ERP folder, backup folder, E drive, wherever we are taking it. And then over TeamViewer, we will find that file in E drive or Max ERP folder, wherever we are taking the backup. And we will transfer that super compressed file to our system. Super compressed file extension will be 7Z, whereas normal Max ERP backup will be ZIP. That is called 7-zip and normal zip. Normal backup will be in extension on .zip, which is a regular file. Super compressed backup will be 7-zip, 7-z would be the extension. But while restore process, it will automatically understand. It will take, it will verify the file extension. If it's 7-z, then it will take that different method for extracting the file and restoring it. If it's a normal zip file, it will use it. So that process will be taken care of by the software. See, the main purpose here was the application configuration. In the support, customers can find our support numbers here. They can find the details that we have. And application configuration is a key part here where all the external settings are available. What all do we have in application configuration? So I'll just quickly go through this. You can again practice out this settings whichever is required, or be aware on what settings are available where. There's an option saying disable notification alerts. If the pop-ups for notifications are not required on the screen, we have a setting through which all the payment reminders, PTC checks getting matured today, or any stocks which are below the reorder level, or stocks which are negative, all that will come in the pop-up every 15 minutes, every 30 minutes. You can define the notification timing here. So if you want in every 30 minutes, it will show you a pop-up every 30 minutes. So if you disable this, means that notification will not be shown. Same way, you have an option saying enable application auto lock, auto application lock. So if 10 minutes, if nothing is done on the software, the user who is logged in, if he is going out for a break without logging out, then the application will get logged and user will have to enter his password again. By default, this is disabled, not required. Set caps lock on at application startup. So automatically caps lock capital letters will get enabled. When you start the software, caps lock will be on. Many of the clients will say that people might forget to start the caps lock every time. So when they start the software itself, caps lock will get enabled, all the letters will be capital letters only. Do not download TeamViewer over desktop automatically. When the software is installed and TeamViewer will come to the desktop automatically. If there is no TeamViewer found on the desktop, the software will automatically be downloaded to TeamViewer again on the desktop. Why? sometimes the customer system itself is not starting or they are not able to connect in the client system, at least they can see the TeamViewer icon on the desktop, TeamViewer QS7, and open and connect us quickly. Some customers hesitate on this also, saying I don't want the TeamViewer on the desktop. So we create a remote setting additionally saying, for those customers we can take this, for that auto download will not happen.
Some people are telling that I have the TeamViewer, I don't have the password, in that case I need to
get it. Net is not working for them. Okay, that's a different thing. And then we have saying disable max network monitoring. There's one more additional add-on we have, network monitoring. Now sitting here I can access entire system screens. I have this facility. Even at the client's place, the clients can access the UI screen of all the systems. Now one of the client has 25 billing counters. The admin has a server machine. From server machine itself, in Max miscellaneous menu, we have an option saying network monitoring. You tick that, you'll find all the systems of the desktop or the screen. And you can find out what they are billing or they are accessing Facebook or what they are doing. The screen will be in front of you. And you can double click one of the system with, along with the system name and time to show. So you can double click one of the system and you can even zoom and see what they are doing. The screen will be in front of you. So that is an additional utility which we launched for all the customers where they can monitor what their staff are doing from one system itself. And they can again question in case if they are not misusing the system or something. If you don't want to enable that, that will consume little additional memory. When network monitoring comes in, there will be some background, all the system screens will be loaded. Some additional settings would be. So if you don't want that also, if it's hampering the system speed, then you can disable that setting also. Next, under backup settings, we have two settings here. Default backup location. In which directory the software should take an auto backup. In this backup folder, it will create one more. So when you see an auto backup happening, under backup it will create a folder for the date time, for that day. So this is the default backup location in which the backup is happening. For every day it will create one backup up to 30 days. And on 31st day, the oldest folder itself will get deleted and the new folder will get created. Each folder will have complete backup every time you close the software. Once you close the software, it will take an auto backup. So see, now currently there's no today's date folder. So if I close the software now, it will create one new folder with current date 12th, and it will take a backup with the current date and time. On that day, it closes the software once, so there's one backup which has happened. If I close 10 times, it will take 10 complete backups in that auto backup folder. And second option is, if this is not enabled, then it will ask you, while waiting, it will ask you whether you want to take backup or not. Some customer says, no, I don't want auto backup to happen every time. It should ask me whether to take backup or not. If this is disabled, means it will ask you whether you want to take backup or not. If you give yes, then only it will take a backup, the rest it will quit directly. Auto backup in application directory only. This purpose of the setting is for a pen drive. Sometimes it's a G drive, sometimes it's an I drive, sometimes it's an H drive. Then this default backup location is not of use. When this tick is enabled, even this is enabled by default, when you install the software, it will take a backup in the same folder of Max ERP/backup. It will automatically find which folder it has been installed. It will take I drive or H drive, whatever it is. Automatically it will find the application directory. Under that, it will find the backup folder and take a backup. We have one second option here saying auto remote backup. Remote backup means you can even take a second backup option. For example, one backup happening in the system, other backup I can give in some other drive or some pen drive or some other network system also. So I can select the second path here. Two backups will happen then. You close the software, one backup will happen on the default directory or the application directory, and the second backup will happen in. Generally, this is useful for many of the clients where they have two systems, one server, backup will happen in one server, and one more backup will happen in some client system. So they'll mention the network folder path, whichever is shared. Then fourth option is do not backup files folder, basically images and attachments. If there are a lot of images and attachments, the backup will take a lot of time to get completed. So over the time, clients who are having 15,000 products, 10,000 products, and they have so many images coming in, they complain about backup taking so much of time. So for them, the data is crucial. Even if the images are not very crucial, they just copy the entire folder once in a while in a pen drive also. So if the software is taking so much time every day or every time when it's quitting, that time to avoid that images and attachments backup, we can take this. So it will not take backup of the files folder. Remaining reports folder and the layouts folder will be taken into consideration. Files folder will have all the documents, all the attachments, all the images. that folder size can grow high if it's being used highly. Second, we have an option saying max local auto backup differential backup only. See, there's a max auto backup which is happening here. If you can see this icon, it says max next auto local backup engine scheduled in 36 minutes. So it is taking backup every 60 minutes. What does this backup do? Even this is taking enable local auto backup, this is taking a backup in eDrive Max ERP local backup folder. Here also we have an option saying enable backup in application directory only. If we take this, it will take backup in the pen drive or in the same folder of Max ERP. And by default, the number of backup days log is 5. When you go to this folder now, local backups, you can find one backup is there on 7th. In today's date, it has not created any folder. So if you just close the software and start again, it will create one backup in today's folder. And what does it do in that? It will take a full backup the first time, and then every 1 hour, you can find, say, 000, 0001, 0002, 001, 002, 34. It will take backup every 1 hour. See, this is a backup for 2, 3, then 3, 3, and then 4, 3. So every 1 hour, it will take backup only of the changes that have happened in the last 1 hour. It will keep a track. First backup will be of the full data, and then every 1 hour, it will take a backup of the changes that have happened in the database in that hour only. It will automatically keep a track of what changes has happened from the last partial backup. This is called a differential backup. Full backup and then the differential backup. Only the differences will be taken into consideration. Then again, 1 hour differences. Database changes and the differences, whatever the differences left, that backup will be taken into consideration. So this is very lightweight. It will keep running every 1 hour and small file will keep getting generated. Useful for large scale customers, supermarkets, textile stores, where the database size will be in GBs. So every time if it takes full backup, it takes a lot of time. So at the back end, night, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, or early morning, the first task happens is once the software is started on the server machine, it will take a full backup of 2 GB or 3 GB. And then onwards, every hour, whatever the billing happens, only those backup will happen. What is the purpose? In case something goes wrong, I can restore it to a particular point of time. I can restore only this 2, up to 2 o'clock, whatever was there, I can restore this and I can continue from there. If I restore up to 3 o'clock, then I will find data up to 3 o'clock. Otherwise, I can restore up to 2 and verify any changes or anything which went wrong. So that is one possibility available in this. But main option is, advantage is, instead of taking full backups every time, every 1 hour, the differential backup happens. This will remain for 5 days. So 5 days folder will come, the 6th day oldest folder will get deleted. And this will happen for every book. Now Shubhshree is there, if BlankDB comes in, even BlankDB full will be there, BlankDB 001, 002 will take for all the books that we have in the list. So clear with what is backup settings? And backup settings will have two things, the normal auto backup settings, application waiting based, and the differential backup. Next we have cloud backup settings. This is not enabled for everyone, but then whoever has availed a cloud backup services from us, the software will take an auto backup every 240 minutes. Basically, 240 minutes are 4 hours. The software will take auto backup of the database to a cloud server. Certain clients, this is a very beautiful feature that we have. Not many clients are still aware of it that we are offering this service. It's an additional paid service where client has to pay us on a yearly basis on this because we are signing up a server space for them. So we have a cost involved here. But what happens is, if the staff forget to take backup or if there's no one to monitor or take in charge of proper data backups, because the data is crucial for the business. If the software goes, we can install it again, but data goes, we don't have anything in that. So there's one option where if that module is enabled, then the software will take automatically backups to the cloud server every 240 minutes. In this, we have two, three options here. Enable from network PC means backup from network PC, even from the client PC it will take backups, cloud backup. Backup from remote session means even when we are logged into some other session remotely of the server, from there also it will take backup. By default, it will take backup only in the server machine. You start the software in the server machine, backup will keep happening at the backend. Same is the case for the backup setting also. You cannot take backup from client system. Neither the local backups or the application quit backup will happen from the client system. It will happen only in the server machine. Because that is where the main database lies. And all the folders and the permissions are there on the main server. It's not available on the client system. Do not mail any report means the cloud backup has one more facility. If the backup successfully done means it will send a successful message that this backup date time has already been done on the cloud server. If it's failed also, it will send a message to us as well as to clients. So certain clients say, I don't want a report every day on this, then you can remove the sticker. That won't send any email alerts. Other settings has few things like do not check for, there's an engine which will verify the max files at the back end, whether new file updates have come or not. Then send SMS and emails from server machine only. Many of these clients have internet only on the server machine. On the client system where the billing counter is there, they won't give internet access. The staff might misuse or they'll use for social networking and they'll waste time. To avoid that, they'll say that emails and SMS should go, but it should go only from the server machine where internet is there. If the check is on means, all the clients when they send the email, it will get stored, but server machine, there'll be even backup max alerts. That's a tool available, max alerts. That will run only on the server machine, which will keep pulling up saying if any email or SMS request has come. It will read that request and execute it from the server machine only. It won't happen from the client machine. By default, it happens from the client machine itself. Wherever there's a request which has come for SMS or email, someone, like let's say we have configured an SMS for sending a thank you message on the counter itself once the bill is generated. So by default, this message will go from that system itself. But if the stick is on, means it will store the request and the server machine will execute this task of sending messages. We are going to learn how to send SMS and email in this session itself. Print document using Max Document Printer. That's one more additional tool that we have designed. When we click print, the software will get stuck for a moment unless the print command gets executed. It might be on hold for 3 seconds, 4 seconds, depending on the time of the system configuration. Once we click print, it will internally generate the print contents, it will frame the design, it will load the data, and then it will send it to the printer. And then we will be able to do the next data entry. Till then, we'll have to wait for the billing to happen. And till the time, we'll have to wait for the printout command to get executed. With this Max Document Printer, if we tick this, then one more printer icon that will come here at the bottom. That is in background service, which will keep running and it will keep verifying if any print request has come. After ticking this, the printout in charge is that application which is running at the back end. You click print in the software and you click printout command, it will internally pass in the, it will pass a command to that document printer. Document printer at the back end will take care of printing, getting that report format, loading the data and then sending it to the printer. The software will not be on hold even for a second. Save, do you want to print? Yes, and then you are immediately ready for the next bill printing or next bill data entry. Useful in supermarkets, again in textile stores where a lot of billing happens, where the people are not willing or they are not having enough time to wait on the counter. And then last one option is there, auto attach and detach database on application startup and close. If this tick is on, means when software starts, all the data in the data folder will get attached to the database engine. And when you close the software, all the data will get detached, all the books will get detached automatically. What is the use? If the customer wants to use the software in a pen drive with multi-user access, means if he puts a pen drive, this the purpose is all the data will get attached and detached to the services. You can move the data or copy the data or change the folder quickly. You will be remaining free to do that. Otherwise, you'll have to manually detach all the databases and then move the system in that way. Basically, we have seen the attach detach option just now. This tick is on means all the database will get detached when the software is closed. When you start the software again, everything it will attach from the data folder again, and it will show all the books. Last option here is ignore computer names, comma separated in a network monitor. Say I'm an admin, and let's say you are also one of the partner or one of the manager, and you don't want your system to be visible to me, neither I want my system to be visible to you. Then we can mention, mark a set of computer names here, which should not be displayed in the network monitoring screen. When I'm monitoring the entire network, the owner's system should not come, my system should not come, maybe there are multiple partners whose system should not come, but the counter system should come. So whichever system should not come, you have to mention the system names, comma separated, like Dell PC, Deepak PC, Subit PC, Suresh PC, whatever it is. What is the computer names that you know, you can put comma separate names. Those names will not be there in the monitoring. Now what happened at the client space was, there was some other admin. Admin was in second floor, owner system also is in the network. So whatever was happening on the owner screen, the admin was able to monitor, which should not happen. So they raised a complaint, we gave this feature. So this is there in the application configuration. These are the external settings that we have seen. Okay. There are certain settings which are internal, and we'll just see those settings now. Internal settings I'll not take in the blank book, I'll take in the Max Enterprises database. So we'll quickly walk through the settings in the inside the software now. First thing which we have saw the application are the external application configuration. Now within the application, what all we have? So Max Enterprises. Basically, we are going to learn about the file menu. All settings are available in the file menu only. So we have an option here: switch to previous year and switch to next year. At a time, we can only do data entry in a particular location, in a particular book, in a particular financial year only. If we want to alter anything in the last financial year, we'll have to click switch to previous year and do the editing. So you can view reports altogether. When you see data, right, let's say from last year and this year, you can club the data and reports and all, everything you can see in a single screen. But when you try to alter anything in the last year, the edit and delete would be disabled. You won't be able to do anything editing. You only will be able to view the transaction details. Now if you want to edit anything in that transaction, then you'll have to switch to that particular financial year and then editing will be allowed. You have an option to change password for the user. Whoever is logged in can change the password. There's a lock option available here. You can log on to Max website, support details and log out from the software. Other side, we have book settings, voucher types, account master setup we have already seen, product master setup also we have already seen. There will be a detailed session on product master setup separately, where we will see the advanced product types that we have. There will be a separate session on custom fields also, where we will look into all the custom fields that we have across the software and the reports that we can see based on the custom fields. GST setup also we have already seen. So we will understand the other options that we have here. See, the architecture of the application is, in a single book there can be multiple companies. This is not for all clients, but we have designed in such a way where if the client has multiple companies also, we can create multiple companies in a single book. For example, Max Business Solution, let's say as a book, single book, we might have Micro Business Solution as one firm, single firm, separate GST number, then we have Jain Info Labs as a separate GST number, then we might have Max Business Solution itself in under it. All three are three firms but clubbed into a single office only. So one book can have multiple companies. Each company can have multiple branches. Branches in the terms we define it as location. So we create them as locations. Each company can have multiple locations. Each location can have multiple warehouses. Able to follow? One database clubbed, one book, multiple companies, each company multiple branches, each branch multiple warehouses. That is the chain architecture that we have. This way we can, I mean, any large scale client whose business is spread across multiple locations, across multiple countries or across multiple branches, everything can be synchronized to one single collaborated data. There we can, from this we can generate any kind of analytical reports and they can do this. Mobile app setup we'll learn in a separate session, it's not covered here. So we'll learn about the certain book settings first. What are the book settings? Settings which are applicable or having impact on this book only, not on the entire software, but within this book. In this book, for example, general settings that we have is, there'll be a lot of settings coming here. What is the rate format that you follow? Certain countries follow triple digits. In case while creating the book, if you have not selected this rate format, then you can alter it here. Quantity subtotal formatting, barcode, do you want decimals in the barcode or not? Many of them will say no, barcode should be rounded value. It should not be 12 rupees 50 paise. It should just be 12 or 50 or 20. No decimals required. So you can change the barcoding format here. Date format can be altered, date separator can be changed. Do you want timing in 12 hours or 24 hours? We have the voucher time also getting printed on the bill. So if it's 4 o'clock in the evening, it will print at 16 hours, XYZ minutes. So likewise, there are multiple settings and you'll find certain description across each of the settings at the bottom. A few of the settings are yet to get updated, but there will be a description for each of the settings. Basically, the setting name itself is self-explanatory, but even though if there's any confusion or need further clarity, you can go and read the description that is mentioned here at the bottom. Let's say this setting has a description. By enabling this, special discount percentage option will be seen in the tax master and will be applied while billing. So tax code wise, special discount is also a possible setting. Why this setting has been created? Certain customer says that they don't want to charge tax to the customer, but they want taxation to be displayed in the bill. So if there's 28% tax, they'll give 28% discount also. Their pricing and margins are already covered, but for their customers, where they are adding 28% of the taxes, they will even reduce the 28% as a special discount. So that will happen automatically. That can be configured with this setting. This is possible that this setting is required only in this book and not in any other book. Book in the sense, the current logged in database file that we are looking at. Opening stock as voucher. By default, opening stock, when you saw, yes, it was only number and you're directly typing the product name. But when you enable this as opening stock as voucher, let's see one simple example here. I go to inventory and I find opening stock. So by default, it is like a data entry screen where you just select the product and type in the quantity. So it's voucher number 2, you just directly type the product name, quantity, date, amount. But when you give opening stock as voucher and you save this, it will have a change on the screen. Again, you go back to inventory and opening stock. Now it will be more or like a purchase screen where it will ask you the voucher number, the date, who has supplied that goods. So then certain customer wants, all this textile store wants the vendor name, which vendor has given that goods. That detail also should be recorded along. So in that scenario, they will create one voucher for one vendor, or they will create multiple vouchers for one vendor, invoice wise. For this particular invoice number, this vendor is given, this all opening stock is left with us. So when they want to do a goods return, they can specifically automatically select that vendor name against that bill number, they can return the goods. Let's understand this later also, but the purpose of book setting is to configure the entire application. Any changes done here will have an impact on the entire data, maybe on the reporting. The application flow itself can be controlled here. For example, let's say negative inventory. Few of the settings that we generally use is allow negative inventory. If this is enabled, then through the software it will allow you to build without inventory in the software. If this is no, means you cannot go ahead without stock. If there's no stock, you cannot do a billing. Same way, you have certain few settings like you'll have to go across each of the settings later to understand what is it about. See, there are more than 100 settings, I think 200 settings here. You can even mention like import quotation to purchase quotation should be imported only to purchase screen, or it can even be imported to order or challan. So you can select that flow. Same way, import sales quotation to sales screen, or you even if you want to import it to order or performa, you can tick this. Then quotation will have a conversion option to a performa or to a sales order directly. Likewise, there are so many settings in this, but the purpose is all these book settings will have impact on the application flow. Block edit after adjustment. This is no by default. If you make it yes, means by enabling this option, voucher editing will be blocked if any adjustment exists against that voucher. For a sale, if there is an receipt entered, then you cannot alter the sales. You'll have to remove that receipt and then only you'll be able to make any changes to the sale. By default, that is no. If you make it yes, means this will get blocked. Otherwise, it will allow you to make changes to the sales bill and maybe you can add more value to the sales bill. But the receipt will be adjusted. If the bill is for 10,000 and receipt has come for 10,000, then you change the bill to 12,000 now. Receipt will still show 10,000 only, but it's allowing you to edit. If I enable that yes, means it won't allow you to change the transaction because there's one more link that has happened to the transaction in the next level. So you'll have to either remove the delete the receipt or clear the adjustment against that bill and then do alterations to the sales bill. You can even select the business vertical here. This is very important that we have the correct business vertical mentioned. If it's a textile store, you have to mention it as apparel and footwear. If it's a pharmacy or pharma distributor, then you have to mention as pharma and healthcare. So likewise, if it's a restaurant, you have to mention as restaurant. The correct business vertical needs to be mentioned correctly. But accordingly, there are a lot of settings which are directly linked to the business verticals now, where you select the correct business vertical and automatically those business vertical related settings will get applied. Say if it's a sweets and bakery store, you can just select sweet shop. And again, sweet shop related, whatever settings that we have will get enabled. Both book settings, voucher settings, whatever is required. So we cannot go in details of all this in the training session, but understand that the purpose of book setting is on the entire book, this book only. It will have an impact on the application flow also. Next we'll see voucher setup. This is very crucial here. Voucher setup, in voucher types we have all the voucher types of the software here, whether it's attendance or sales. See, everything is there. Attendance, we still don't have the payroll enabled yet. all the voucher types will be displayed here: sales, retail, sales return, order, purchase, purchase return, POS. What do you mean by a voucher type? Basically, a data entry screen is a voucher type. Now, whenever we see all these menus here, there's a separate voucher type for sale order, there's a voucher type for delivery note, there's a voucher type for sales invoice, sales return. And there can be multiple voucher type linked with every screen. For example, sales invoice, there's bill number 4 running. Now I want to segregate like retail customer separately and wholesale customer separately, means I can go to this voucher types. I can select, the screen is called sale, and I can just select a voucher type name saying, let's say retail, and give RETA as some short name. I can copy the settings from an existing sale itself, from existing voucher type. Whatever is the print setup and settings required, I can directly select. I want print setup, I want voucher settings, custom fields. Whatever has been configured for this will get copied here also. I can quickly save here. What happens with this now? I'll have two voucher series in the sales invoice. One is retail and one is sale. Sale is having bill number 4. The retail is bill number 1. Now with this retail, I can have discount column, or I can have different set of expenses. Same way, I can have retail can be tax inclusive, and this normal sale can be without rate plus tax. I can have different print format for retail, different print format for sale. And print format also, we have like under sale itself, I can have multiple print formats also. Retail having one small format, sale having one full A4 size invoice format, sale also having one A4 half option also, or dot matrix option also around. So I can have multiple print types or print options for each voucher type. This is termed as voucher type. Now we have created one more new voucher type. So there can be, with every transaction screen, there can be n number of voucher types associated. With each voucher type, there can be n number of print formats linked. I can have discount column for retail, maybe for sale I might have a discount column at the end of the bill itself, not product wise. In retail I might have product wise. So I can configure each voucher type accordingly. How do we configure this now? What all options do we have in this? Basically all the transactions are voucher type. And each of this transaction, you can see the menus also. Right from the beginning we've seen this earlier also. First setup is called as transaction menu, transaction info, where this is split here. All these are transaction entry screens where I can do a data entry. And second set of all the menus will be report. Same as the case with purchase, accounts, where you are able to see everything. First set is an end transaction info, second set is report. So I have reports of that particular module on this side, and there is the data entry screen. And each of this transaction can have n number of voucher types. I can have multiple receipts from local people, local clients, receipts from outstation clients, or check receipts separately, bank receipts separately. I can even link that way. So each transaction can have n number of voucher types. The example we have seen in the sales here. Now to configure anything in the sale, if I want to make some configuration, let's say I want to enable discounts, I want to enable tax on expenses, I want to enable bill wise discount also. As well as I want to configure some additional expenses here like courier charges, delivery charges and all. How do I do that? Either you go to file and voucher types and search for that particular voucher type, retail or sale. Alternatively, you can open that particular voucher type on that screen itself, and you can go to options and configuration. This will automatically search it for you and open in the screen. Here I can just go to settings. POS type means, see, POS is also a sales, point of sales. If I tick this, means that particular voucher type will be linked and will be shown in POS screen. That is also sale, this is also sale. If it's linked with the point of sale screen, where it's a supermarket or textile store with barcode scanning option, then there's a separate menu available for that screen. If this tick is enabled, then it will be shown there. By default, even we have a POS also in the search, if you can see. Now we have three in the sales, POS, retail and POS is already connected with the POS screen. Sale was already connected with the sale. We have created retail again linked with the sale. Now how do I enable discounts here? I can go to settings. In settings, you can find there are a few options here: print setup, voucher settings, custom fields, screen and validation, and expenses. Let's say I want to enable discount. So print setup will be linked everything. I mean, in print setup, you'll find everything about printout. If you want to change anything in the print configuration, you want to add a new print format, that will be coming as a part of print setup. Custom fields will help you configure additional fields both on the billing master level as well as individual item wise, which you can even configure in the printout. Let's say after the product name, I want some description to be typed. I want some description column or some measurement column here, which should be typable, where I can type anything I require, and then it should even come in the printout. So I can, those custom fields we have to configure, that can even be configured in the printout or connected in the printout later. The first thing we'll do is we'll just configure a discount option. General settings which we generally customer will ask us is, I need a discount column or any discount over on bill wise. So you'll go to this configuration, settings, screen when validation. In screen validation, this first option available saying apply product wise discount. I can give this yes. Show product wise discount amount. If you want to see the amount also, I can enable, otherwise not required. Some customers will say, I even want the discount amount. If there's a 10% discount on 1000 rupees product, it should show 100 rupees on the discount amount. If that is required on the screen, you can enable, otherwise not required. Same way, we have second option of discount on the product item wise. When we discuss product wise means for individual product. When it's a bill wise means for the entire bill, it will come on this side. When you go second, we have two discount options for individual product as well as two discount options on the entire bill. So I give discount two requirements, it will even show the second discount. Let's say bill wise cash discount required and bill wise cash discount amount editable. And then we even have a second option saying bill wise special discount required. If this is enabled, then even this will show second discount on the bill wise. Amount editable means it will show you percentage as well as directly option for typing an amount. If the customer bill is for 1050 and he says give me 50 rupees discount, then you can directly type the amount itself as 50 rupees instead of calculating the percentage you might not know. See, after doing this, we'll just save and come back to this. See, for all the settings, there's a description available which you can read for your reference purpose. Now I have just done the setting for sale. Now when I go to retail, it's the same thing. But when I come back to sale, now you're able to see there's a discount available here. There's a cash discount percentage and amount has come. And I can type the amount directly or I can type it in the percentage. Same way, special discount percentage I can type here and amount also I can type here. But this is only configured for sale, not for retail. So I go back to retail, those options get hidden. For each order type, there's a setting that we can configure. So typical setting is this one, where we configure the discounts. Either on the product wise, this is product level discount, we have configured one, and bill level we have configured two with the amount editable. Other settings that we generally use is, we go to configuration again and there are certain column options saying whether pre quantity required. When we enable this, you will even get one more column next to quantity saying pre quantity. Whether do you want product wise salesperson to be configured? See, by default salesperson is on the entire bill. When we configure it product wise, for individual product we can configure the salesperson. There are a lot of settings here which you can again go through, and sometimes the customer will say that even it should allow zero rates or zero quantity. There are some settings related to tax, so you can enable tax on expenses. Now after GST it's become a compulsion where there should be taxation on expenses also. We are charging courier charges, and if the bill has, how it's getting calculated is, if the bill has 5% product or 14% product, as per the ratio of the product, that much tax, I mean the expense amount will be split among all this product, and accordingly the product taxes will be applied to that amount. There's 100 rupees expense and there are two products, one with 5% and one with, let's say, 15% or 18%. Then that 100 rupees will be split among two products, let's say 50 rupees each. First 50 rupees will have 5% and second 50 rupees will have 18%. It will be divided, the expenses will be divided among the ratio of the product, and that product taxes will be applied for the expenses as per the ratio. So this is one general setting that we will generally enable tax on expenses. And there's one more option saying show tax inclusive option. Let's see what is the difference here. Allow zero rate in the voucher. While billing, if customer says I want to give something free, by default zero rate will not be accepted, it won't let you save the bill. But in certain cases where you want, customers will say us that I want zero rate, it should accept, then you can give the CS. Allow negative rate, allow zero quantity or negative quantity. If you enable the settings, then accordingly it will allow you to change this, accept the value. Allow negative value in the voucher. At the bottom grand total, can it be negative or not? If you mention this yes, then it will allow negative. Otherwise, by default, generally sales will not have a zero value coming in. By default, it's all no. Certain cases, when we require it, we will configure it for that. What to type here? These are the two general other settings which are being applied: disable voucher number sequence verification, disable date sequence verification. What is date sequence verification? This date and the bill number sequence should be in parallel. Bill number 10 having date of 10th October. Bill number 11 cannot have date 9th October. Either it will be 10th or 11th. More than that. But in certain scenarios like receipt payments and for purchase voucher, a client will ask us to disable this because purchase can come in any date. I can enter a purchase of today's date, then I can enter purchase of yesterday's date also. But in sales, as per the rules of government, it has to be in sequence only. So by default, it's no. Some customer will say, I'm using it for my personal use only. I don't want to track all that dates only. Then we'll enable them for them. Okay. Same way, disable voucher number sequence verification. Date sequence is for the verification of date. Voucher number sequence, again, in today's date, I can put a voucher number of 13th. Tomorrow's date, I can put voucher number of 12th. This number basically will be manually editable by the user. By default, it's not manually editable. System is defining the number on its own. We have a setting where we can define the starting number, prefix, suffix to this number also. All the settings are there. We'll see that one in the next. But then, if you want the number to be manually editable, then you have to enable this disable voucher number sequence. So these are the general settings which are basically used on a regular basis. Do not apply previous supply dates and previous supply discount. By default, software will automatically bring customer-wise, product-wise, last supply date as well as the last supply discount. In cases where customer says no, it should not display whatever is last time, I will manually put in or whatever is the product master defined rate that should come, then you have to disable this too. One more special setting that we have here is disable current date for new voucher. What do you mean by this current date for new voucher? This is only useful where client is entering old data. When client is entering some last few months data, not previous year. See, by default, let's say software has been taken today, but I have to do entry right from October 1st. Then every time I select October 1st, I do the data entry of the bill and I save it, it will come to current date automatically. It will bring today's date, 12th. Okay. Then client will find it, they might get irritated because every time they have to change the date. Otherwise, if they mistakenly enter one data in 12th, then again voucher number sequence verification alerts will come. It won't allow you to save. And they go back to that voucher, change the date and come back. So when you enable this disable current date for new voucher, if they've entered one date, entry in 1st October, after save new is, screen goes blank, the date will still remain in 1st October only. It won't change it to current date. These are all small phone settings that we have here. Hide rate and amount column. If you don't want rate and amount column, you can hide that. Hide quantity and rate column. There are certain other settings like enable hold option, enable terms, custom voucher terms. If I enable this, I'll find one terms option here where with this particular bill, I can choose the terms that are required for me. For example, here the sale enable this. So you just have to go through each of the settings, read the description and try understanding what is the use of it. Basic settings I have already explained to you. Now what we have seen is configuration of the discount, enabling tax on expenses. I have even enabled one show tax inclusive option here. So now once I come here, it says rate plus tax or net rate. The tax inclusive option is giving me an option, new option on the screen. Whether in this bill I want to bill customer as rate plus tax, for example, I select a product. Okay, Parker pen that we have seen here. I give 5 pieces at 100 rupees. When it is rate plus tax, it is taking 500 plus 60 rupees, which is 560 altogether. And when I give a net rate option, the bill total itself will change to 500, if you can see at the bottom. The 500 has been splitted as 446 and 53 equally. Okay. Able to follow? Net rate and rate plus tax. Same way the terms option has come at the bottom, where with this bill I can choose the term that is required. 50% advance, 50% subject to change deduction, and then I can proceed. So this term will come in the printout. I'll have an option to choose the terms also. I can predefine the terms also for a voucher type. Rather than choosing it for every business, I mean every bill, either I can choose it for the customer, that will take a relevance, I mean that will take a priority, or else I can choose it for a voucher type so that when I print in retail, this set of terms will come. When I print in normal sale, this set of terms should come. I can even choose that. So default setting is discounts, enable tax on expenses. Now I have enabled this. When I mention 100 rupees here, since it's a single product, it is bringing 100 here itself. Let's say I go with the second product also. Part of them. Let's say 1 into 50 rupees. Now I type, let's say 100 rupees again. This will split as 91 and 8.7. On this 8.7 rupee of tax, it is applied 18% tax. On this 91, it is applied 12% tax. This 100 rupees is split among these two products as per the ratio of the amount that is available. 550, so this has to be 10 times. So 8.67 into 10 will be 91.833. So it will automatically segregating as per the ratio of the amount and applying that product tax. This is how the expenses after GST, they have made it a little complex, but this is how it has to be followed. So this is how taxes on expenses is coming in. Disable previous applied rate history, disable previous supplied discount, we can do that. Discounts we have already seen. And disable date sequence check, disable voucher number sequence check. These two are important things which you'll find routine calls coming for that. Not for sales specifically, it might be for journals or for purchase voucher or for reception payments also. Auto round off also can be disabled. Some customer might say that I don't want auto rounding. What is the accurate value that should come? In that case, we can disable this auto rounding as a part of book settings. In book setting, we have this. Clear with this? So screen and validation will all be about setting up or validating or configuring certain options of that particular voucher type only. Okay. What else we have next? Let's say expenses. I'll come to expenses. Let's say we want to configure multiple expenses here, courier charges, delivery charges. So for expenses first, I need to create a head in the general ledger saying delivery charges. Under expenses is indirect and I'll have to save this here. Let's say you want to configure one more saying packing charges. I go to options here and configuration again, settings, there's an option at the end saying expenses. I can just say delivery charges and I can click whether it should be added to the bill or it should be reduced from the bill and save it here. Adding to the bill, same way packing charges, adding to the bill. Sometimes if I want to less something from the bill, I can even have one additional option saying less value or discount in the bill. See, one discount, generally how discount works is on the subtotal it will reduce the bill discount. If there's a subtotal of 1000 rupees, 100 rupees is discount, means subtotal less discount 900 rupees, and then taxes will get applied. Taxes will get applied only after the discount is being done, not before the discount. In certain cases, if the discount is required after the taxes, and then you'll have to configure the discount option here. Okay, let's say I've just added two charges here. And I go back to this new. Sorry. You can find delivery charges, expenses, packing charges. Now I can write against this. And then I can track a ledger of all the delivery charges on which all bill, how much delivery charges we have accumulated. Again, we have to pay back to the delivery person guys. So we bill it to the customer, we pay back to the delivery persons who was taking care of. We'll see a print setup now. How does this print setup work? By default, there's a setting available, GST and sale. The default setting would be in the voucher type name itself as a sale. After GST has come, we have even configured an auto setting for GST bill format. It's a laser or dot matrix is being asked here. This will require little awareness because there are many options on the single screen. And each of this has one good utility purpose. So let's say we create one more new format saying A4 half. Whether it's if any existing format is inactive, you can search, edit, mark it as inactive and save. So that will not be, no more be listed while bill printing. A4 half, what do you want in the title of the bill printout? When we see a print preview, we have a title coming at the top of the screen. Whether it's a tax invoice or credit tax invoice. So what is the title required at the top of the screen? You can just mention the title, let's say, again, tax invoice itself. Then reference number title. What do you mean by reference number title? Against the bill number, there will be a reference number coming. It will come as invoice number or sales return number or pro forma number, purchase order number. So what do you want as a caption? Let's say I want to say wholesale bill number, WBO. BN, sorry. Or just WINB. Not NB. So I can select this. You can even lock it for a bill type. If you select something here like cash or credit, only for cash bill that option will be displayed. If you select credit, only for credit bill that option will be displayed. If it's blank mint for both of cash or credit bill, see we are selecting the cash credit here. So if it's blank mints for both, it will be displayed. If you want one format only for cash bill separately and credit bill separately, you can restrict that format here. Then it's asking whether it's a laser format or a dot matrix format. When you select dot matrix, some options on the screen changes. Select laser also, this option which is changing here. When you select laser, all the reports file, all the crystal reports which are available in the reports folder of Max ERP will get listed here. So let's say I just select A4 half wide with MRP. I can click this design for editing the report. When I click this design, Max Report Designer tool will get opened for making any changes to the bill format that is selected here. So you can alter the format that is required. You make the changes whatever is required. We'll have a separate session on this, on the crystal reports on how to alter. But we can alter whatever format that is required. So there are two options here, export file name and print file name. Print file name is the one which is being used for the printout. And in case if we want to email a different format, then if it's blank means by default the print format itself will be used as an exporting format also. But let's say sometimes a customer will have a pre-printed stationery with their company details already printed and all lines, boxes, logos, address, everything will be printed. Only the content of the product and the taxation information comes from the software. So when you basically you design that on a plain paper without any boxes. When that same format we try to email, it will look very awkward because it will go as a plain without any background, no company name, no logo and all. To avoid that, while printing we'll use that pre-printed stationery format and while exporting we'll use a plain A4 size paper format. That time we'll use two different formats. While printing, it will print on the pre-printed stationery, but while emailing, it will use the export print file format, which will have the complete borders, lining, logo, name, everything, address and all in place. That will be used for emailing. Okay. Next we have printer name. Which printer this format should be printed to? If I have two printers separately, for A4 half separate, A4 full separate, I can choose a printer name in which it should print. It can even be a network printer name which is on sharing. If there are 5 systems and there is a separate dedicated printer for the entire network for A4 half and a separate printer for A4 full, I can select a network printer and it will print that document in that printer only. If the network printer is not found, it will print to the default printer. And even if it's black also, it will print to the default printer. After selecting a printer name, you can even select the paper size on which it should be printed, either A4, A5, legal, whatever it is. You can select paper size. Paper source is all general. You need not select this. This option is generally not used. But if you have multiple trays also, in certain printers there are multiple trays where A4 full size can be in the bottom box, A4 half can be in the middle box. So in case if there are multiple trays, then you can just select lower, middle, upper, which tray it should pick up the paper from. Then automatically, if same printer but multiple trays, it will pick up the paper from there. Number of bill copies that should be printed by default, 2 copies, 3 copies, it will copy that many copies by default once you give print. There is a print type option available, general and packing slip. General is for the invoice format, packing slip is something which will come additionally print out without giving any additional command. There is a separate utility for the packing slip also, and that is not very important also, so we will not cover that. Anyways, packing slip is for quick printing of a additional printout format without much options on the screen. We'll see that later as an example. Then we have next option is copies type. How many copies do you want? Original, duplicate, see in the printout you'll have a copy at the top. This bill copies is different and this is different. This will print the caption along at the top. Original, duplicate, triplicate you can keep and that caption will also be printed at the top. Whereas number of copies, if you give 2, original will also get printed 2, duplicate will also get printed 2. Okay. So I can select, let's say, two copies. Any declaration that you want at the bottom of the in the voucher printout. For this A4 half printing, you want, I declare that all this information mentioned is true, and any message also, if you want, you can select that and you can save this. So I've selected A4 half. Now where it is being used? So when once I click previous now and I click print, so it is asking me GST, which is having original tick by default. Then I get A4 half, which is having original as well as duplicate by tick by default. And then the old sale, which is not having any print options. So when I select this and see a preview of this A4 half, the format which is linked with this A4 half will be in the printout, in the print preview. Now tomorrow when a customer has A4 half as well as A4 full, how do you configure it? This is the way where you configure. So this is coming in A4 half, you can see. Half of A4 with original for recipient coming at the top. This is the voucher type title, credit, wholesale tax invoice. And this is the reference number that we can, the blue invoice number. This I am not given in the GST invoice. So when we give printout, we select GST and click the preview. The credit sale invoice is the print title and invoice number is the reference. Able to make up. And this is full A4 size. Let's say P and E mentioned here. P is the print file name, E is the export file name. When we send an email or when we try to export data, the export file name will be used for exporting. When we use for printing, the print file name will be used. By default, if the print export file name is blank, means the print file name itself will be used for the exporting also. What is the purpose of print file name, export file name? Print is for printables, export is for emailing. If your pre-printed stationery is there, and you design the content as per the pre-printed stationery, all these boxes and all will already be printed on the screen. Customer name, address, I mean company name, address, and all these details. Most of the information will be already printed on the stationery, and you'll only have to fill in the blanks with the product name and the perfect location for just in code, quantity, rate, amount. You won't find all these lines in the preview. But when you email that format, it will, for printing it's all correct, but for emailing that will not be sufficient, it will be incomplete. Then we'll have a plain paper format like this, which will have all the lines drawn with the company name address as an export file name, and that will be used for emailing purposes. What other options do we have in this configuration? So we have print setup, we have second option saying dot matrix also. Dot matrix, it will show you a DOS file name, it will show you all the dot matrix format which are available in the reports folder. Dot matrix, we have an inbuilt tool which we have designed for report, for the designing of the report. The extension here would be MPT, Max Print Formats, basically. When you design this also, this will be in little different way. We'll see this design in a separate form, separate session. Anyhow, we have a separate session for the printout. But in dot matrix, you'll be able to select the dot matrix format as well as the two other options saying build model. We already have certain predefined designs of printout for different clients, one for thermal printer, one for A4 half, one for A4 full. And each of this have certain model numbers which will be informed to you by the developers of the. We will have a separate list of this, we have a document on that. So if a customer is having a predefined format, you need not design the new format for them. You can use that number saying 1, 2, it will be a random number, 100 for a particular format for a thermal printout kind of thing. So if you use that predefined model number, that printout will come automatically. You need not even select anything here. It will internally print out. Basically, predefined set of printout formats are already programmed in the software. So instead of customizing it for the customer completely newly, you can use the existing model, but you cannot make any alteration in the existing model. That will be a fixed set of options. In a fixed printout, you cannot make any alteration. Here we can design a new format and make any alteration required. Tab space is nothing but the starting left margin. And dot matrix works on alphabets. If you want 10 alphabets or 5 alphabets blank space and then it should start printing, means you have to give 5 here. Automatically 5 spaces will be left blank for the entire printout for each line. And dot matrix basically works in lines and alphabets. It has individual space for each alphabet, as well as one paper will have 72 lines. Half page will have 36 lines. A letter size page will have 32 lines. Half page will have 36 lines. And it has 80 columns and 132 columns. 80 column strings, 80 alphabets in a line. That is a fixed thing which is available in dot matrix, unless the fonts are small. Standard fonts are on 80 letters only. We have two additional options here, saying forward feed and reverse feed, which is coming for the laser also, which is coming for the dot matrix also. What is forward feed? What is reverse feed? This is only useful for printers which has an auto scrolling thing. Dot matrix printer has that roller turn where we can scroll the printer and make the adjustments from where it should begin. To adjust the margins on the cutter level, when a printout comes, sometimes it will be little inside. We cannot tear it, then we have to adjust the ruler and then we have to tear the paper and then keep it ready or reverse it back. So reverse feed is nothing but reverse and forward feed is, reverse is automatically the roller will scroll at the, there's a command internally which the printer understands. It will automatically scroll line wise reverse, in a reverse way. Only purpose for this reverse and forward is for it to bring it to the cutter level. After the bill is printed, you need four lines to auto extend extra so that it comes to the cutter level, then you can give forward feed there. When you give four here, four lines will come extra additionally blank. It will leave blank space and the roller will scroll automatically up to four lines. If you give 10 here, it will scroll up to 10 lines as required. Certain customer might require 9 lines, so up to 9 lines will automatically scroll and we can cut. But after 9 line cut, it has to go back to 9 lines for it to print correctly from the next, for the next bill. So there you will even give 9 here as well as you will give 9 there. It's not 9 specifically, as per the printer configuration, as per the stationery available, this configuration will be working for different clients. But forward feed is, after the bill is printed, how many lines, blank lines it should leave for the cutting, for the print to come to the cutter level exactly. So quickly you can cut the paper and give it to the customer, the bill. Same way, after the bill is printed and it's been cutted and given to the customer, for the next bill print, it will automatically go for 9 reverse and then it will start printing. Generally both will remain same, or there might be one or two difference between each. As per the different printer, this configuration might change. So we will do this for the dot matrix printer. Certain cases, we are designing laser print, laser report for dot matrix printers. In that scenario also you might require, this crystal report itself will come in the printout. Slowly it will print. Laser printer will print fast, dot matrix printer will make noise and will print slowly. But many of these clients are using this for dot matrix printer. Laser printer itself will be used for the dot matrix printers, and there also you might require this reverse and forward. It will go reverse, start printing and go back to forward. Understood reverse and forward? In case if you get a question on what is reverse feed, what is forward feed, you should be able to understand this part. And what else we have left is, next is the voucher settings. With this we'll be able to, voucher settings and custom fields. First we'll understand custom fields. See, there are certain custom fields at the master level. What do you mean by master level custom field? Let's say I, on the entire bill I want delivery address to be manually entered. So I can just give delivery address 1. I can select a field type saying string, or whether it's a drop down or it's a drop down list. What do you mean by drop down list? Drop down is a set of values, predefined values, plus I can type a new value. Drop down list means this is a set of predefined values among which I will have to choose one. For example, let's say drop down list, I can give here courier. I have to use a separator like this, pipe and courier or vehicle. I can give like delivery type. I'm just giving a custom field here, then I can give delivery address 1. String is just a text line. Memo means more than one line. Number would be a predefined number only, it won't accept alphabets. Boolean means yes or no. Basically it will show you a tick option on the screen. Yes, I mean tick, untick. Date would be a date thing. So I can define what this field input should be, predefined here. Let's say I'm giving a string here, in del 2. So these are master level. We have category of saying master level, and then we have something for the product level. Product level means it will be listed here. Let's say product description. Then I need under warranty. I can select boolean here. Let's say any size. I can save this. So now I have selected 3 on the billing master level and 3 on the product level. I click new again. I go back to this retail and I come back to sale. I'm finding description option here. I'm finding an under warranty option, which is a tick box, you can see, yes or no. And then I have size. If I give date, it will accept only date. If I give number, it should accept only number, kind of thing. So with the individual product, I can type additional information here, which will be stored in the software. And with this is product level. I can even configure this in the printout. Okay. The bill level information will come on the other details, where you'll have a custom column saying custom field, where I can, since the first one I have given as list, I'll be able to select only among this courier or vehicle drop down list. If it's only drop down, means I can even show these values as well as user can type a new value. Here I cannot type any new value. I'll only have to select from the list options available. And I can type in delivery address 1, I can type delivery address 2. And even this can be configured in the printout. So this fields are called as BM underscore custom 1, BM underscore custom 2, master level. Whereas this is called BD underscore custom 1, BD underscore custom 2, BD underscore custom 3, billing details level. BM and BD are linked in the crystal reports, where we will see how to configure this in the print format. It will come during that time. So these custom fields are done. We have a lot of reporting connected with this custom field also. We can filter different options as per the custom fields and see different reports. We will specifically have a separate section on custom fields, both on the master and the transaction level, and utility of the same. Next in the configuration, the final option that we have is the voucher settings. In voucher setting, I can just predefine whether the default bill type should be cash or credit. See, for sale, it should be credit, but for retail, it should be cash. Then I can select predefined, so that every time I don't have to choose this. For retail, it has to be cash only, it should not allow credit, means I have to fix this. Fixed means I won't be able to alter this thing. Same with tax code also. Earlier we had option for VAT, where we had an option where user could change the taxes. Now in GST, everything is local only. But for outstation, if there's a separate bill series, earlier it used to be if outstation separate tax code was there, I could fix that tax code for outstation bill series. Outstation means that tax code only. Local means that tax code only. On with GST, this is almost obsolete now. Set this voucher type as default. What does this mean? When I open this screen, this should come, sales should open by default, should not show retail. Among multiple voucher types, which should be coming by default? There's a small settings available, so this will be by default. Let's say I give credit, fix it. In sale, it should not accept cash at all, it should be credit. Starting bill number, I can mention the start number should be 1000. Then the bill number will start from number 1000. See, till date I've been using a old software or some manual bill series, and now I'm switched to system. So my old series or old software had last number as 1800. I can just give 1801 as the starting number. Understood. So the first bill number will be 1800. Ending number also, if required, we can define. If it's 0 means, it will continue with the first number itself. Ending number also, it should not go beyond 2000. After 2000, maybe I might go with a new series or something. I can define an ending number. Again, the length, prefix, suffix that we have, we can define applicable date-wise prefix. Let's say as on 1/4, the prefix should be INV hyphen, and the suffix should be hyphen is not allowed. Suffix can be like slash 2017-18. So the bill number will be INV hyphen 1 slash 2017-18. If I give a length of 4 years, it will be 0001 INV hyphen 0001 slash 2017-18. Next year in the same software, when I am continuing, it should not come 17-18. It should come 18-19. That time I'll have to add one more row here saying 1/4/18. Again, this can be INV hyphen, and here I can just select slash 2018-19. This will not have impact currently. When I save this, since the date range is between this, only after 1/4 it will start applying this new prefix. Till then, whatever is the old available, it will start applying that. It will apply that only. Set voucher type as inactive. I can just mention as inactive. This will not no more be this voucher type will not be displayed here. Earlier we saw was print format inactive. This is voucher format inactive. Here we even can define predefined terms and condition. For sale invoice, it should always be no return, no exchange, subject to channel rejection, 100% payment in advance, and I can proceed. See, in terms and condition, I can even move them up and down. There's an option to move. First, I want subject to general direction, means I can move this up. So the positioning also I can define here, and I can proceed. Okay. The prefix suffix is clear here. Bill number generation starting number is also clear. Number of products also I can lock. In the bill, it should not accept more than 20 items. So if I mention 20, it won't accept more than 20 rows. I can predefine a price list along with this. When I select sale, wholesale prices should be applied. When I select retail, that retail prices should be applied. So prices also can be linked here. Default credit days with this prices can also be defined here. For wholesale, instead of defining for each customer, should be 30 days by default. So for every bill, it will start applying 30 days. Enable print file selection, it's already enabled by default. If we have more than one voucher type, it will automatically allow us to select the print format. This will even though if we don't have defined the print option where we've selected A4 and A4 half, if you still want to select it dynamically while printing, then this option will show you all the crystal reports available in the folder. You can select any one and you can give for the print. Do not clear screen after saving. Once you save the bill, the screen will still remain as it. It will not go to new. You will have to call new manually. Small settings only. Print after save. If you don't want to print after save, then you can take this sticker. It will not print immediately. You will have to click the print button manually. Where it's useful, when I'm doing the whole data entry, that time I don't have to take print out again and again. Then every time it will ask, do you want to print? To avoid that, we can click take this sticker. And once it says, after save, some customers say it should not ask for print at all. It should immediately print. And this print confirmation, if the tick is off, means it will not ask, do you want to print, yes or no. It will directly start printing. And this tick is on, it will ask, do you want to print, yes or no. If you give yes, then only printing will come. Default email subject for this voucher type. When this transaction is being emailed, this bill, what should be the subject? You can predefine a default subject as well as default email body also can be defined here. Dear customer, as per the wholesale invoice that has been generated, for retail you can have subject, for wholesale you can have subject. Offer message and footer message. In the print format, let's say I give happy Diwali offer, buy for 1,200 rupees. Okay. Or something is coming. Footer message I can give like happy Diwali. Thank you, visit again. So I understood all the options here. They're all general options only, but you have to be aware which option is available where. What happens with all this? Now I go to previous bill and I click a print. I select GST invoice and click preview. See, the terms will start coming in. See, the offer messages come at the top. Diwali offer, buy 100, get this has come here. In the footer, I'm getting this happy Diwali, thank you, visit again. Plus the terms have started coming in. So this is there with the settings. These are the default export formats. The email formats are available.
Invoice number.
It's coming three. It's not come because this is an old invoice. Now if I just click edit and save again, then only the new number will start getting applied. We want to print. Confirmation is there, so it is asking a print. Since there are multiple print formats, it's asking for a preview. If this original duplicate is ticked, then only this preview box will come. Either multiple print formats are there or any one of this is enabled. If there is only single print format with no original duplicate, then directly the preview will come. Now it's giving an option for the user to see. Now this invoice INV-0003/201718 has come. The prefix and suffix. If I put a bill now in 1/4/2018 means this automatically will be 18 and 19. To shorten this or to reduce this, this option has already been given here where append fin year after document number. If you take this, means automatically after the bill number, the financial year /18/19 will come. Instead of defining for every year, if you take this, it will come by default. Okay. Copy voucher option is also understood. If we are copying it from now, if I open one more invoice format like wholesale or some other name like outstation, then I quickly copy from sale itself because all the settings I have configured in sale. Need not configure all this thing again for one new voucher type. I can quickly copy it from it. Or I want to copy only the print option or custom fields only. I can choose that whichever is required. And that can be copied and can be applied to a new voucher type. for sale transaction quickly, or for any other transaction also you can copy from other vouchers. Clear with this? So in this session, what all we have summarized? We have learned about default book settings, default type of voucher settings, the print settings, and expenses, how do we configure, terms and conditions, how do we define the voucher settings, prefix, suffix, definition. The default credit has come here, and we have an option to set up terms here also. So these are the settings related to books and the voucher types. We'll see next set of other settings and other details of the file menu in the reference session. Okay, right, we'll stop here. Thank you.